Reading with your kids. Hola, ni hao, konnichiwa, assalamu alaikum, shalom, jambo, bienvenidos. Hi, my name is Jed Lee, and this is the Reading with Your Kids podcast. We are coming to you from the beautiful neighborhood of Reedville in the southwest corner of Boston, Massachusetts. Please be sure to subscribe to the show on the iHeartRadio app, on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, wherever you find your podcast. Our guest today is Brian Ray. He is back on the podcast to tell us all about Maya and the Very Tall Wall. Before we invite Brian into the studio, I would love to invite you to visit my website, wewillroar.com. We Will Roar, respect others and read. It is my educational magic show that is now available to schools all over the world through the magic of technology. That's right. I have adapted the school show that has entertained kids for decades. Entertained literally millions of kids for decades. I've adapted it to be just as much fun and just as interactive through technology. I really love it, and I'm really so pleasantly surprised at how much fun I have presenting the show through Zoom. I am also delighted at how much fun kids have experiencing the show through Zoom. Nothing beats being in front of a live audience, live right there where you can see the kids' faces and hear them react, and they can be a part of the magic on stage. That can't happen right now, but we can still inspire our kids to respect every single person they meet and also make sure that they spend time reading every single day. And we can do it in a fun way with lots and lots of totally interactive magic. You can find out all about it, and you can see lots of comments that educators who have hosted the show have made, like Chad Wynn, the principal at Van Rensselaer Elementary School in Rensselaer, Indiana. He said, "The students and staff love the show. Everybody was completely engaged from beginning to end as we laughed and oohed and aahed throughout. The message was perfectly tailored to our school and reinforced our messages. I would recommend Jed Lee's We Will Roar to anybody. And I would love to come and reinforce what you are teaching your kids and letting them know how special they are and how important it is to be respectful and to read. So please visit wewillroar.com. Joining us online right now from Brooklyn and New York City, he's returning to the show to celebrate a brand new book called Maya and the Very Tall Wall. Please welcome back to the show, Brian Ray. Brian, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me back.
Super to speak to you again, and super to celebrate Maya and the Very Tall Wall. For some of us who are challenged vertically, lots of walls seem very tall to all of us. Tell us about this book, please.
This is the story of Maya, who is a very curious, imaginative girl who loves asking questions about how things work. But as she gets older, she becomes shyer and shyer about asking her questions out loud. And there's a magic wall in her backyard. And as Maya grows shyer and shyer, the wall grows higher and higher, essentially cutting her off from the things around her. And the thing she's most curious about is what's on the other side of this wall. But she's too shy or embarrassed to ask that question out loud. And finally, her curiosity becomes so great that she can't hold it in anymore. And she speaks up and she says, "I want to know what's on the other side." And something really wonderful happens. I won't give it away, but it's something that even Maya couldn't have imagined.
That's really, really cool. And it reflects reality for a lot of people. And I think it reflects reality for a lot of people, especially now. You know, I remember when my kids were growing up and they would ask anything, like literally anything. And then a lot of the questions were surprising. And then, you know, they hear, "Well, that's not an appropriate question to ask," or "You shouldn't ask that here," or whatever, and peer pressure. And so that's part of a natural part of kind of growing up. But it seems like right now we're living in a time where, boy, if you ask the wrong question or if you just kind of verbalize a thought or a different way of thinking, you can get, I guess the word's canceled right now, and it seems terrifying. I imagine it must be terrifying for a lot of kids.
Sure, I would imagine so. I think, you know, everyone, you know, we're all different, and we all, you know, but I can tell you that I was a lot like Maya as a child. I felt, you know, I was curious, I was imaginative, and as I grew older, I definitely felt sort of self-conscious about speaking up or asking questions, and it took me a long time to feel confident using my voice. And as you said, right now, for children growing up, there's a lot of sort of messaging, direct or indirect, that suggests, you know, you better be careful before you say the wrong thing, which, you know, for people that might be naturally uncomfortable or not as sort of self-confident in speaking up could be really troubling. And that's the last thing we want for our kids.
Yeah. And I think it's the last thing we want for our culture, because, you know, questions, I think, are in answering questions and exploring questions. That's kind of how we grow.
Absolutely. Absolutely. When we teach our children how to express themselves with confidence and to state their ideas, their self-esteem grows. Mm-hmm. They perform better in school, and it helps them build more positive relationships with their peers because they can have a dialogue. And that will just grow over time, because it also helps them deal with conflicts in a more constructive way. Mm-hmm. And helps them manage their emotions, which, again, is particularly important at this very moment.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, one of the things that we're always, you know, teaching kids is to speak up for themselves. If somebody is hurting them, to speak up for themselves. Or if, you know, they're having a conflict, to use their words instead of lashing out in anger or frustration. And if kids aren't feeling able to ask questions, then they're not going to be able to stand up for themselves. They're not going to be able to be in control of their emotions.
Absolutely. I mean, it's sort of an odd thing, isn't it? I mean, you know, it's a weird mix. Parents have to, a line that we have to walk in a way. I have two kids. And, you know, from the time that children start speaking, we also start teaching them to be quiet. You know, whether it's shushing them in grocery stores or waiting rooms or, you know, any number of places, there's a lot of emphasis placed on being quiet and listening. And I understand that that's important, obviously, especially in a classroom situation. You know, a large part of learning is listening. But there's also something valuable, like you said, about being able to speak up, to voice questions, and to speak up for yourself. So it's just as important to create an environment where a child feels comfortable, you know, speaking up, and encourages them to speak up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, you share with us that you were like Maya in a lot of ways. Is that what inspired you, or was there something else that inspired you to create this book?
Well, I was definitely like Maya, and that had a lot to do with it, because I know that feeling of, you know, sort of feeling self-conscious about curiosities that I have, or questions that I have, or things I wanted to know. You know, they didn't fit into sort of what the expectations were. But also, I noticed with my older daughter specifically, just like Maya, as she grew older, particularly starting around the age of 6 or so, I would say, she began to withdraw a little bit. She was speaking up less, asking less questions, and it really made me wonder why. And I did some research and found some remarkable studies that said that that's really not it's very common for mm-hmm. that to happen, especially with younger girls.
Fascinating. You use it's interesting that you use in this book, you use the wall, this
yeah.
you know, kind of ordinary thing that we see a lot of. We see, you know, I'm surrounded by 4 of them right now, so they're part of our lives to the point where we don't even notice them half the time. And you also use the image of a box, and Max's box, the book that you spoke about on your last visit. What is it about these right. kind of everyday objects that you're drawn to?
Well, I think it's mainly because they are everyday objects. Everyone knows what a box is. Everyone understands what a wall is. Mm-hmm. But a wall can be more than one thing. It can be used for, you know, protection against the elements, but it's also, it can be sort of a self-imposed barrier. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I sort of leaned on that for the metaphor.
Yeah. Why do you think it's more difficult for girls to speak up than guys?
Well, I think adults, you know, in the last decade or so, I think adults have definitely begun to focus on nurturing, you know, girls to, and encouraging their bravery. And it, but a crucial step in that process is helping girls to strengthen and use their voices effectively. I think girls receive messages, again, both directly and indirectly, every day that tell them their voice doesn't matter. I mentioned, you know, sort of doing some research as my older daughter started to sort of withdraw or become quieter. And I discovered that a study that said by the age of six, young girls are far less likely to see their own gender as being brilliant, for instance. Mm. Another study I saw said that around one third of girls asked they didn't want to be leaders for the fear of being thought of as bossy or making people mad at them. So it's, they're getting these messages, you know, that it's not okay to be bossy, you know, to speak up. And despite, you know, some wonderful advancements in the culture for women, little girls, young girls are still getting this message that maybe their voice doesn't count as much.
Mm. What? You know, one of the things I know, I'm very happy that I had heard this for a long time from other women. So when my daughter was born, one of the things that I did with her is sit down with her and say, you can do anything you want.
Right.
I am here all for you. Now, she pushed that a little bit when she was, you know, she was a dancer. And then, you know, in when she was six or seven, she wanted to dance and she also wanted to play tackle football. And my
right.
wife couldn't quite wrap her head around that. And thankfully,
right.
dance was more important to her than playing football. So we kind of dodged that. But, there are, you know, I kind of overcompensated for it. And I was like, no, you can speak up and you can do, and we're here to support you. What are some of the ways do you think that we should be more aware of that, you know, some of the messages that parents and that I might have done that kind of contributed to that, oh, don't be bossy, don't speak up kind of attitude that girls are hearing from folks?
Well, it's really encouraging to hear your story because I think one of the most important thing is for boys and men in the lives of young girls is to demonstrate that their voices are valued. Teach them that their voices matter.
Mm-hmm.
When a young girl contributes to a conversation, let her know that her contribution is valued. Let her interrupt and listen when she does. You know, that's step one, is just valuing what's being said.
Mm.
I think giving girls a voice means giving up some of our own control as adults too, which is something that's sort of counterintuitive in a way for some parents, you know. But adults need to listen and relinquish some control when a young girl vocalizes something that she wants, you know, to send the, you want to send the best message that her voice has value in the world.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's, you know, you use the word listen a number of times. And I think one of the things that we as parents need to remember is listening isn't waiting for our turn to speak.
Right.
Listening is actually listening and hearing the words and letting them resonate. And you don't have to agree with it, you know, but it is
right.
important to listen.
Absolutely. And again, it's, you know, it's starting in small ways because learning to use your voice is, again, adults, you know, we've been speaking up for so long that we think it, maybe it just comes naturally. We forget that like everything, it's, there's a learning process involved. So doing something as simple as saying, it's time for lunch. What do you think we should have? You know, encourage them to participate and speak up in that way. It can be that simple as a way of starting, you know, bring them into the dialogue.
Yeah,
it's age appropriate, but it gives them the chance to vocalize their feelings.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that, with both of my kids who are now, you know, they're adults and they're wonderful and they're happy and they're successful, and they're wearing their masks and they're being cautious. So everybody out there, remember to wear your mask and be cautious. But
absolutely,
one of the things that we did a lot growing up, you know, I was the family Uber driver for the most part. My schedule was much more flexible. But there were a lot of times, a lot of trips that we took where the radio was off and the devices were off. And we would just spend time in the van talking to each other, sharing ideas. And I think that as families, we're, you know, I know in my van right now there's a DVD player and a hard drive with music, and it can Bluetooth and all this other kind of stuff. There's so much distractions that we have this time together when we're traveling 20 minutes to school or 15 minutes to the dance class. And a lot of times that those 15 minutes can be precious and can really do a lot just to have a conversation with our kids.
I think that's so true, and it's particularly true right now. Mm-hmm. I think with all the changes that everyone's going through, those changes, you know, we know can lead to increased anxiety and sadness, and we need to provide opportunities for our kids to vocalize how they're feeling right now. You don't want those feelings to stack up, because that can lead to anger and other problems down the road. So creating those moments, you know, 15 minutes in the car is perfect, you know, especially for older kids, you know, mm-hmm. but younger kids too. Yeah. For younger kids, I know at our house, we make time for reading every night, reading a story together and then talking about the story. We make time to do art projects, and, you know, there are many times when, you know, my younger daughter is very intensely drawing, and I'll just say, it looks like there's a lot happening in that picture. And, you know, slowly a story starts to come through the picture. She's telling me what's happening. And more often than not, it relates to something she's experiencing or has experienced in her life. And it's just a great way to get her to talk and to talk about what's going on. And these are moments that I think that we would really all benefit from creating for ourselves.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, one of the things we've talked a lot about here on the show is, you know, that reading together and talking about a book, it's a wonderful way to start a conversation. And it's really empowering when you turn to your son or your daughter and you say, what do you think about this? How important is it when you take the time to ask that question, how important is it for the parent to then kind of understand that, you know, when you say, what do you think of, that they can't be wrong. You might not agree with them, but you kind of have to, you know, you ask their opinion. So what they tell you, it's, you know, you kind of have to accept that.
Right. Exactly. You have to let them lead the conversation and be the listener, essentially.
Yeah.
Again, you know, it's not about, you're not starting the debate. Mm-hmm. You're starting a discussion. So just listen, you know, offer thoughts, you know, if you'd like, but just let them get out what they need to get out, I think is what's most important, especially when you're talking about a moment where you're discussing a story that you've read.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's particularly important is let them lead the way mm-hmm. in that instance.
Yeah. And it's a great way to find out what's going on with your kids.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Younger children in particular, I think, need to feel a connection to the grown-ups to help regulate emotions and help keep them calm. And again, story time and having a basic discussion is a great way to create that connection.
You know, one of the things that I sense when we spoke before about Max's Box and now having this really wonderful conversation about Maya and the Very Tall Wall. Sometimes I feel like I'm not talking to a children's author. I sometimes feel like I'm talking to a therapist. And in a good way, you know, you have these great insights into kids. Where, other than just being a dad and being aware of being a dad, where does that insight come from?
Ooh, that's a great question. I think largely, I do have to say it comes from being a parent. I did not grow up learning these skill sets It's something that I had to learn, and it was sort of, you know, the baptism by fire when I became a parent. One of the most difficult things was helping my children manage their emotions, helping them feel confident, helping them get through these basic developments. And I wasn't, so I had to do a lot of reading, and I had to do a lot of on-the-job training. Now when I sit down to write the stories, you know, these stories are inspired by personal moments, whether they come from my childhood or something I see with my own children. But then I do a lot of reading and a lot of research before I sit down to actually write the story. First and foremost, they are stories. They're meant to entertain and hopefully, you know, bring some joy to the kids that are reading them. But underneath, you know, there is something there that if the parents want to discuss, there's something there to discuss.
Yeah. Just wonderful. Now, you've also written screenplays, and I know that's what you studied in college. Any desire to bring your books to the screen?
I would love that opportunity. That's something that I do think about. I wish I knew the path to get there, but I would be thrilled if there was any interest in taking a story like Maya and the Very Tall Wall, you know, even to the small screen. I think without giving away the ending, there's an opportunity to take Maya's character and really expand it into, you know, even an animated series about the possibilities of, you know, using your voice and working together and what that can accomplish.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. Well, you know, I'm always told I shouldn't be asking about works in progress, but, you know, I don't like to follow the rules. Do you have a new book that you're working on?
There is a book that Shiloh and I have already, Shiloh Penfield is the illustrator that I work with on the books, and she and I have finished a fourth book, which is set for publication next year. And we are currently working on a fifth book right now.
That's wonderful. Well, I'm really excited. I think that these are really great books. Like you said, they are entertaining. And that's one of the beautiful things about books is that they can something that's really, really entertaining can also be something that can start a conversation that can really help families dive into a subject that they might find difficult to talk about, you know, without the book. And so I'm excited that you're creating these really wonderful stories. What's some of the feedback that you've received from folks who've experienced the books?
The feedback on Max's Box was so honored, humbled, and thrilled. There was a great response, and especially as things began to escalate with COVID and people's lives were so disrupted. I was asked to speak to a number of people about the book and, you know, how to help children articulate their emotions. Again, you know, given all the change, you know, children are affected by that too. Even though they might not have, or still might not understand fully what's happening, their lives have obviously been affected from school to their ability to see friends or relatives. So, there was a lot of discussion I was having about how to, you know, how the book might be used as a tool to guide kids through the emotions they're feeling right now, and that, you know, suppressing them is not a healthy thing to do.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, you bring up a great point. Before the interview, you and I were talking about, you know, the state of reopenings in our two cities. And, you know, we're talking about the gym, and gyms aren't open in New York City. They are open in Boston, but I haven't gotten back to one yet. My wife isn't totally comfortable about that, and I think we forget. It's like, you know, if I at this advanced age am feeling uncomfortable going back to the gym, imagine what a 4 or 5 year old must be thinking as they're hearing these debates about whether or not kids should go back to school and wearing a mask and not being able to touch our friends if we are back together with them and there's no recess and we're eating our lunch in the classrooms. And, you know, hopefully we're getting to the end of the COVID-19 pandemic, but we have a lot to talk about with our kids. There's still going to be lots of conversations that are going to be had with our kids for a long time to come.
Absolutely. I think you're absolutely right. And, you know, it, like you said, it's important to remember that they're going through this too. They have questions. And as adults, we can watch the news and we can read the papers, et cetera, and do our best to try and rationalize and come to terms with what's going on. But a child, you know, especially of a certain age, really just probably has more questions than answers. So it's important for adults to sort of make sure that we're checking in with our kids regularly, ask them how they're feeling, encourage them either directly or indirectly to sort of speak about any questions they have or feelings that they have. Because again, suppressing them just can lead to more problems, mm-hmm. that they don't need to be dealing with, like increased anxiety or sadness or just even feeling alone. Mm-hmm. A growing sense of loneliness can happen. When they feel sort of lost and without answers. And figuring out age-appropriate ways to talk to the kids about what's going on is important too. Because if kids don't have answers, sometimes they tend to fill in the blanks with their imaginations, mm-hmm. which can be far worse than the actual truth.
Right.
Which could increase anxiety. So it's very important to be talking about these things and to encourage them to vocalize these things as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, I know folks are going to want to know where they can find out more about Maya and the Very Tall Wall and also find out more about our guest, Brian Ray. So, Brian, where can folks connect with you online?
I have a website, which is www.authorbrianray.com. Or if you're interested in the book specifically, you can go to Schiffer Publishing's website, or it's available on Amazon or any other online bookseller.
Yep. And folks should remember that Brian spells his last name Ray with a W, W-R-A-Y. So it's authorbrianray.com.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, welcome. You're welcome. We've had a great time speaking to the author of Maya and the Very Tall Wall, Brian Ray. Brian, thanks so much for being back with us today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Please be sure to join us for the next edition of the Reading With Your Kids podcast. Our guest will be Anne Gonzalez. She'll be here to celebrate Beloved and the Pepper Tree. If you are the author of a great children's book, we'd love for you to check out our Reading With Your Kids Certified Great Read program. It's an exciting program that has helped so many authors really help their books stand out from the crowd of books that are published every single month. You know, there's literally thousands of children's books published every single month. And it's really, really hard to get noticed. Our program is a great way to let families know that they should take the time to check out your book. You should check it out today. You can find out all about it by going to our website, readingwithyourkids.com. Click on the author services button. You see at the top of the page, it'll let you know all about this great, effective, and affordable program. I want to thank the folks who made today's show so very wonderful. Of course, I want to thank our guest, Brian Ray. Be sure to check out Maya and the Very Tall Tree. I also want to thank my team, my producer, Fatima Khan, my awesome author ambassador, Peggy Cotto, my amazing daughter, Alejandra. And of course, I want to thank my beautiful wife for all the support she gives me. But most of all, I want to thank you. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. And as always, thank you so very much for taking the time to make the world a better place by reading with your kids. I'll be looking for you in the next edition of the Reading With Your Kids podcast.